story, which will probably become a big story of science, probably for history, kind of like, you know, I don't know, evolution and Darwin or something, you know, like those kind of things where somebody's thought to be wrong for many years and then turned out to be right. And even for this workshop, you know, people have commented how everything's sort of coming together. You know, to understand, like in Eugene's talk, you saw, to understand text, maybe you need to go to images and videos and vice versa. And all of that comes out of this new revolution in learning, and we'll get to hear more about it.
Thank you, Sanjeev. You know, I don't think I'm going to be able to, you know, like fulfill expectations now that you. So sorry. Apologies in advance. Okay, this is not a title slide. It's just a logo. That's a title slide. So I'm going to talk about unsupervised learning. That's been kind of my obsession for the last couple of years, really. And you know, a little less than an obsession before then, but still kind of a you know, pretty important topic for me. All right, so we all know about supervised learning, of course, and you know, we can train things with lots of data, and you know, everything works out if we have enough data and if we have armies of people labeling our images, Mechanical Turks or whatever. But the question I've been asking myself is, if we want machines to acquire common sense, is there any way we're going to get to this by just collecting more data and labeling more data? There's a lot more knowledge about the world that exists that machines can collect by just observing the world that we'll never get them to acquire by just labeling stuff. And the argument, I heard that argument for many years from people like Jeff Hinton, not believing it initially, we're talking 30 years ago, and believing it for the last 20. But not being really able to act on it. But you know, it's amazing what we can do with supervised learning, right? We can train a ConvNet on image recognition. We can train it to, and it learns representations. And it's kind of amazing that the representations that it learns, the filters that are learned by a conventional net at the first layers, you know, are things that are natural that you would build by hand if you were to build it by hand, that people used to build by hand. Hog and Sift basically do the same stuff as a conventional net. They are the things that pop up if you train any reasonable unsupervised running algorithm on natural images. You will get oriented edge detectors, right? The first person to show this is at Berkeley now, Bruno Olshausen. So it's kind of interesting to see that either supervised or unsupervised running will give you the same results when the features you are interested in are kind of very, very close to the data. That's basically determined by the statistics of the data, not so much by the task. But as you go up the layers, the representation is more and more task dependent. And so the question is, you know, is there any way to learn representations at a high level that are task independent, in a kind of task independent way, and then sort of have a little bit of tuning on top to learn task dependency? Of course, there's a lot of results where, you know, you take your favorite ConvNet, you train it on ImageNet with 1,000 categories, and then you have another image recognition problem to solve, and you fine tune that network with a relatively small amount of data on whatever problem you're interested in. And people have done things that are kind of weird, you wouldn't think work, like, you know, train on ImageNet and then fine tune for X-ray analysis, or for, you know, extracting roads from satellite images, or you know, counting, you know, estimating the population density in satellite images. And it kind of works, you know, transfer learning sort of works. So there's something intrinsic about images that those networks learn that are relatively task independent, and you need just a little bit of tuning for them to learn. You know, one of the things that people should remember about conventional net is that they are actually biologically inspired, very weakly biologically inspired, but there is a lot of inspiration from classic work in neuroscience, Huber and Wiesel, et cetera, simple cells, complex cells. That's where it all comes from. And what we're seeing, and you could think of a conventional net as what neuroscientists call the ventral pathway of the visual cortex, where you know, the visual cortex is like the back third of your brain, if you want. And there is, you know, a pathway that kind of goes to the bottom and one that goes to the top. And the one that goes to the bottom is the one that you use to identify objects. And the one that goes to the top is the one you use to localize objects, obstacles, navigate, process, motion, and things like that. And what we're starting to see in computer vision is sort of a split, again, of the pathways in conventional nets, where you have a ventral pathway that identifies categories of objects, and then a dorsal pathway that basically figures out masks for the objects that are being looked at. And so this is a paper from a couple of years ago by Pinheiro Colobert and Pierre Dollard, all at Facebook. And that, you know, produces pretty amazing results when you put it into a big system and you do multi-scale, blah, blah, blah. You can actually download the code and play with it. It's open source. You know, you get results like this, where objects are outlined, including what they're really blurry, you know, like the bottom left here. And objects are segmented. You know, you can pick up broccoli in Chinese dishes. You can count sheep. And so more recently, another group of people with some overlap at Facebook AI Research, Kaiming He, he's the inventor of ResNet, he's not Facebook. Georgia Gocheri, who actually used to be at Berkeley here at Bayer, Pierre Dollard, and Ross Gershik, also a Berkeley alumnus, came up with this very simple architecture of a convolutional net that they call Mask RCNN. And it's basically a convnet you apply to a whole image, which for every location produces a category for the kind of main object in the picture, in the region of interest, if you want. It produces a mask for that object. It produces coordinates of a bounding box. And it produces, if it's a human body, it also produces coordinates of key points for the human body, so you can do pose estimation. And this thing works amazingly well. It's very simple. It's been trained on the COCO dataset. And you know, it produces results like this, where you get the bounding box, the mask, everything for objects that overlap. You can count, you know, how many. It's always sheep. I don't know what's sheep. Various types of objects. Cars that are behind each other. You can actually segment individual instances. So this is not semantic segmentation. That's what's called instance segmentation. If you have multiple objects of the same category, it tells you all of those objects. I mean, it's kind of amazing, right? You know, it's like we have computer vision solved or something. Not exactly, right? There's a lot of problems we don't know how to solve in computer vision, but it's really, really cool. And this works at, you know, this runs at 5 frames per second on a single GPU in testing mode. So what that means is that 3 years from now, we'll run on your smartphone in real time. This is the results you get for pose estimation. So all of this is supervised learning, right? So supervised learning can take you quite far. But there are limits, and really what one of the things some of us at Facebook and other places are after is how could machines acquire common sense? This is an old holy grail for AI. This is not something that just popped up in the last year, but you know, people in sort of traditional AI, logic based AI, etc., have been after this problem for a long time, but it's still a little elusive. So what does that mean? Okay, so the TLDR here is, to acquire common sense, machines have to figure out how the world works by observation and perhaps by action. And short story is that unsupervised learning is the missing link here. So, you know, that's, in my opinion, the main obstacle to real progress in AI, sort of, you know, taking machines to the next level. We're going to push supervised learning as far as we can, you know, in natural language understanding, translation, computer vision, you know, all the applications, the traditional applications that actually work. But really, if we want to be able to dialogue, hold a dialogue with a machine that can answer any question and not sound really stupid when we talk to it, we needed to acquire some sort of common sense. So what does that mean? You know, a machine will probably have to have an architecture something like this, where you have some sort of agent that produces actions that act on the world, and that agent gets an idea of the state of the world through a perception module. And we have a good handle on how to do this. You know, that's what I just showed. That's supervised, but you know, it works. And what the agent is trying to do is optimize some sort of objective, which is, this measures how happy the agent is. And one question we might ask is what does this agent have to have internally to kind of be able to act intelligently? And it has to perceive, of course. It has to kind of keep and maintain a updated idea of the state of the world. It has to be able to predict in advance what's going to happen in the world just because the world is being the world, or perhaps as a consequence of its actions. And then it has to be able to reason and plan so as to bring the world to a state that will make it happy, right? So, and you need a predictive model of the world for this. So essentially you need those different modules, perception, predictive modeling, memory, reasoning, and planning. And a lot of those things we know how to do. What we don't know how to do really is predictive modeling. And so that's what I'm going to spend a lot of time talking about. But before, you know, what is common sense? It's not entirely how you define this, but it's clear how you define this. But there are certain things, there's a classical test, you know, text-based test in AI, like Winograd's schema, that show that machines do terrible at figuring out the, you know, the reference of a pronoun, so what objects a pronoun refers to. So this is called a Winograd schema. You have a sentence like the trophy doesn't fit in the suitcase because it's too large, or the trophy doesn't fit in the suitcase because it's too small. The it in the first case refers to the trophy, in the second case to the suitcase, and you kind of have to know how the world works to be able to lift the ambiguity here. So there's a list of like a large number of those, and machines are terrible at this. People are quite good. Here's another example. I say, Tom picked up his bag and left the room. You don't have to know anything about Tom or the room or the bag. You can imagine a scenario by which Tom will extend his arm, pick up his bag, you know, close his hand, stand up, walk, probably towards the door, open the door, etc. He's not going to dematerialize. He's not going to go right through the wall. He's not going to fly. He's going to attract his bag by telekinesis. You know, there's a lot of things you know are not going to happen because you know how the world works. How did we learn this, right? Nobody actually, you know, told us all those facts about the world. So how do we get machine to learn all of those facts about the world? You know, it's billions and billions of facts if we were to kind of write them all down. In fact, there is a guy who for 30 years has managed to have a large team typing facts into a large database and hoping that in the end common sense will emerge. This guy's name is Doug Lanet. Some of you may have heard of this. This is Project Psyche. He had a company called Psycor. It's been bought by another company called Lucid now. But that's their program. They've been at it for 30 years. No learning whatsoever. It's all typing facts and rules. So my hypothesis is that common sense is the ability to fill in the blanks from partial information, right? So you can infer the state of the world from partial information, from just perception, or, you know, good information about the state of the world. Infer the future from the past and present, or predict the future from the past and present. Infer past events from present state of the world, from observation, quite useful if you are a police investigator. You know, our brain does this all the time. We have a blind spot in a retina that we're not conscious of because our visual cortex kind of fills in the blank, but there is a piece of our visual field where we don't see anything. So filling in an occluded image, you know what the backside of my head looks like, more or less, even if you've never seen it. If you look at my left profile, you can figure out what my right profile looks like. Most faces are more or less symmetric, except in, you know, Hollywood horror movies. And you know, a lot of things that you can fill in because of all the knowledge you have. And so from very short sentences, that the one I mentioned earlier, you can, you know, infer a lot of things that are, you know, true or likely to be true. So that might be a hypothesis for what you know, how common sense can emerge. Learning a lot of different things about the world. So this is there's another argument, and it's an argument for unsupervised learning from Jeff Hinton that, you know, he said those things for 25 or 30 years. His argument is the brain has about 10 to the 14 synapses, and we only live for about 10 to the 9 seconds. So we have a lot more parameters than data. This motivates the idea that we must do a lot of unsupervised learning, since the perceptual input, including proprioception, is the only place where we can get 10 to the 5 dimension of constraints per second. And so if you ask a machine to predict lots of variables, you're giving it a lot more information and you constrain a lot more parameters, and therefore you can afford to have a much bigger machine, which means it's going to be smarter just because it's bigger. I mean, that's kind of a hand-wavy argument, but it's sort of what's implied here, right? And we're not going to get that with human-provided labels. We have to be able to get machines to learn from just observing raw data. So that led me to this obnoxious slide, which has become a bit of a meme in some machine learning circles because it's obnoxious. And it's basically an analogy for the measure of the amount of information that you provide to the machine as feedback or that you ask the machine to predict in each category of learning paradigm that we know about in machine learning, right? So in reinforcement learning, the feedback you give to the machine is one scalar value once in a while. You tell it, oh, you did good, or you did bad. And it's not even in every trial, right? You have to wait for a sequence of events to occur. So that's not much. And the result is that the sample complexity of pure reinforcement learning totally sucks. You have to have millions and millions and millions of examples for a pure RL machine to learn anything useful, which is why it only works for games. It doesn't work in the real world. Because the real bad news about the real world is that you can't run it faster than real time. So that's, you know, what I mean by pure is really model-free, okay? Because what I'm going to argue for later, which is why I'm going to make it up to RL people, is that I'm going to advocate model-based RL, okay? So supervised learning, you're giving a bit more information. You're telling the machine, you know, here is the correct answer. Among all possible answers you could produce, here is the correct one, and there is one correct one. So that's a lot of information you're giving to the machine. Unsupervised learning, you're giving even more information to the machine, but it's unreliable. So you're telling it, you know, here is the past in a video. Here are a few frames of a video. And you're asking the machine, predict what's going to happen in the future. Predict what the world is going to look like half a second from now. And so it has to predict a lot of variables, and therefore there's going to be a lot of constraints, and it's going to be able to constrain a lot of parameters. The sample complexity is not going to be that large, except that this information you ask it to predict is unreliable, because there's a lot of things that can happen in the world that are basically unpredictable. And so you can't ask the machine to make just a single prediction. You have to ask it to predict kind of a whole set of possible predictions. And that's where things become difficult. That's the main technical difficulty, in my opinion, solving this problem of predicting under uncertainty. Is the main technical obstacle to making significant progress in AI, if you want to reduce it to kind of a small small thing. So, but you know, we get millions of bits per sample. So, you know, this cake, so, you know, that's the analogy of intelligence is a cake. The bulk of the cake, the Genoise, is unsupervised learning. The icing on the cake is supervised learning, and the cherry on the cake is reinforcement learning. And, you know, RL people get pissed, all right? But please don't, okay? Bear with me for a minute. I'll make it up. Also, be aware of the fact that this is a Black Forest cake, and the cherry is not optional. In fact, there is cherry inside, so. In fact, at Facebook, we do quite a lot of work on RL, including model-free RL. This is an example of some work led by Yang Dong Tian in Menlo Park on, you know, playing Doom. And he actually won the competition, the last Doom competition with the system. It's basically a ConvNet, you know, trained with reinforcement learning with a few tricks. We do quite a bit of work as well on slightly more complex strategic games like StarCraft, where we use RL for, you know, tactical battles and things like this. And, you know, the sort of normal RL doesn't really work. You have to kind of make some tweaks to make it work. And one of the problems that needs to be solved there is not just how to learn tactics for battles, but also define sub-goals for strategy. It's basically hierarchical reinforcement learning. And no one really knows how to do this properly. Like, how do you decompose a complex task into simpler subtasks and set sub-goals for the things. That's a big conceptual problem that nobody knows how to solve, and it's a big obstacle also to progress in AI. Okay, so here is I'm going to, you know, whenever I make this this argument that model-based RL and prediction is really a big problem in AI, people may or may not believe me, but here is Rich Sutton back in 1991 proposing an architecture called DINA, an integrated architecture for learning, planning, and reacting. And he has this really nice little statement at the beginning of his paper in 1991. The main idea of DINA is the old common sense idea that planning is trying things in your head using an internal model of the world. In fact, it's not just an old common sense idea. It's also the standard way you do optimal control, right? Everybody who does robotics or optimal control does that. This suggests the existence of a more primitive process for trying things not in your head, but through direct interaction with the world. Reinforcement learning is the name we use for this more primitive direct kernel trying, and Dana is the extension of reinforcement learning to include a learned world model. So here is the grandfather of RL saying, RL sucks. Let's use model-based RL, and let's call this Dyna. Okay? Now, we don't call this that anymore. We call it model-based RL, but that's the basic idea. And there is an interesting phenomenon that the old guard in RL, so people like Rich Sutton, Jerry Tesoro, he's the person who built NeuroGammon, that was a backgammon playing neural net that was actually trained with RL. All these guys thought that by the mid-90s, about the same time when the community abandoned neural nets in favor of SVM and boosting and things like that, the RL community abandoned model-based RL for very, very simplified models like bandits and you know, MDPs with discrete states and blah, blah, blah. And basically, the interesting part of RL disappeared. So it's parallel kind of changes. And those guys say, like, I'm not interested in this anymore. I'm not going to work on this anymore. And then they're coming back to it now because, of course, you know, you can use neural nets for that. So this idea of using a model to plan is a very, 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 very classical way of doing optimal control. You have a system to control, which in control theory is called a plant. Okay, it could be a rocket or a car, whatever it is. And you have a simulator for it. You have a model, a mathematical model, maybe that you wrote by hand. Maybe it has a few parameters that you identify by kind of trying to fit your model to data. And the advantage of this model is that it's differentiable. It's a bunch of formulas that you can propagate gradient through. And so what you can do is hypothesize a sequence of commands. With the sequence of commands, run your simulator from an initial state of the world. Okay, and then by gradient descent, essentially by backprop through time, you can think of this as a recurrent neural net. It's not a neural net, it might be a model that you wrote. Optimize the sequence of commands so as to minimize a sum of, you know, an objective function measured over time. Okay, this is the standard way of doing optimal control. This is the way NASA computes trajectories for rockets since they've had computers, you know, in the early 60s, essentially. So when you have continuous commands, when you have, you know, differentiable models, that's what you do. In fact, then, you know, the control community invented this process of doing gradient descent in that space back in the late 50s, early 60s. It's called the adjoint state method. And it's basically backprop through time. Optimal control people invented backprop. They just didn't realize you could use it for learning. Yeah, you can have a look at this this book, Applied Optimal Control by Bryson and Ho, 1969, and it's all, we have backprop in there. It's all written with Lagrangians and all that stuff. So let's go back to the architecture of the intelligent system. We need perception, we need an agent that acts, that does the planning, reasoning, working memory, etc. You need an objective that, you know, tell the agent whether it's happy or not. And the objective is a function of the state of the agent. It's not something that comes from the world. It's not like traditional reinforcement learning where you get a reinforcement from the world. Here, the thing that determines whether you're happy is a kind of hardwired objective function that takes your state and tells you whether you're happy or not. In fact, this could be learned as well. But for now, let's assume it's fixed. It's immutable. And inside of the agent, if you want the agent to act intelligently, the agent needs to have this world simulator model, essentially, that allows it to assess a situation, predict what's going to happen in that situation, you know, if the agent doesn't act, or as a consequence of the agent's actions. There has to be an actor that generates action proposals, and a critic, and the role of the critic, this is kind of classical RL objects. The critic, the role of the critic is to predict the long-term value of the objective. So, you have to be able to predict if you're going to fall when you learn to bike, right? And you can predict this in two ways. You can have the world simulator that tells you whether you're going to fall or not by kind of rolling out a sequence of actions in your head. And then your critic will kind of predict whether you're going to fall or not, and that's going to make you scared. That, you know, that's one of the modules that kind of produces fear, if you want. And you know, you're going to find a sequence of action that sort of leads to a good outcome. So we know how to build the actor and the critic pretty much. What we don't know how to build is the world simulator. But in fact, if we had a world simulator, we could play the same game as the optimal control people. You know, we can roll out a sequence of actions produced by the actor, and then you know, train the actor to kind of learn a policy that optimizes the, whatever comes out of the critic. Okay. In fact, we can do better than that. We can use the classical optimal control thing, which is by gradient descent, we estimate an optimal sequence of actions, and then we use, you know, in such a way that it optimizes the objective. And then we use the sequence of actions as targets to train the actor that actually just computes the policy. So that is something that I think Shyam Kakadej was just talking about, that you don't want to have to do this optimization step every time. If there is something you're going to do over and over again, what you'd like to be able to do instead of running your simulator every time and, you know, running this optimization algorithm to figure out what actions to take, you actually want to train an actor to directly predict what good action to take. And so, you know, what's going to happen to a system like this is that the first few times it encounters a situation, if it has a good model of the world, it's going to do this planning by optimization. But then eventually the actor is going to be familiar enough with the situation that it's going to be able to directly generate the correct sequence of action for that particular situation.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Ask a question?
Yeah.
Is there something missing from this model, since it's all kind of a rollout model of going forward? And I kind of think for humans, when they plan, they do this sort of backward chain, right? That if I have some goal that I want to get a job at, you know, whatever it is, my goal is to get a job at FAIR, I'm going to start backward chaining some things to achieve that, not just do rollouts and see where I end up and evaluate them.
No, I mean, the optimization process to find the sequence of action that optimizes a particular cost function, that's the backward chain, right? You have to do...
finding my goals. I'm just sort of doing rollouts, right, and seeing where I end up and evaluating that.
I mean, this is exactly this backward chain is exactly the process that optimal control uses, where you want the final objective, for example, to be something, right? So you want to shoot a rocket as to rendezvous with a space station or something. So you can measure the distance to the space station after a certain time, and then you say, I want to minimize that distance, so I kind of roll back. Where do I have to be, you know, an hour before I get there, or a millisecond before I get there, and et cetera. And that's what you can do this by gradient descent, but, you know, you have to do this shooting and backfilling multiple times, or you can do it through if everything is discrete, you can do it through dynamic programming. So it's basically, you know, let's explore where everything goes, and then let's backtrack once I find a sequence that takes me where I want. You backtrack to those things. But it's true that there is kind of a more high-level reasoning process by which you define sub-goals, etc. That's what's missing from this picture. That's what's missing. That's what we need for problems like StarCraft, for example. You know, define sub-goals. It's not entirely clear how you do this. There is some interesting work that is largely ignored in that direction. There is Greg Wayne's PhD thesis, for example. So Greg Wayne was a student in neuroscience at Columbia with Larry Abbott, and he is now at DeepMind, and he came up a few years ago with, I think he published his paper in Neural Computation 3 years ago or so. And he had some idea of how to do hierarchical goal setting. It's kind of like the equivalent of deep learning, but sort of for generating actions instead of perception.
I guess maybe what Chris is saying is that maybe in this whole picture, there's no node which says get to Facebook. And somehow you reason it out like...
Oh, that's the node. That's the node that says get to Facebook.
Sorry?
This guy tells you how far away you are from Facebook.
No. But you didn't even know about that until that question was asked. How do you get to Facebook? And then you start reasoning it through something like that. I'm not sure if that's what the question
was. Yeah, I'm not sure.
Is there a difference in dynamic programming with pruning and searching with gradient descent? Pruning is essentially what Chris is describing. Back and only stay in the high value states, right?
So, you know, in a discrete world, if you play chess or Go or whatever, you know, some of those strategy games, then the number of actions you can take is limited, and so those rollouts basically correspond to tree exploration. And then, you know, at the end, so you can do pruning on the way, you can do beam search, you can do all those things, minimax, alpha, beta. And, you know, by the time you get to the end, you have a value for your value function, which is you win or you lose, or you have some estimate. You know, the critic is actually like an evaluation function for a position. It's not necessarily the end game. And then you can backtrack, you know, what action should I take now so that I get to that goal, which is the best one among all the ones that I've explored. So what I'm talking about here is this process, but in the continuous world space, essentially, where you have gradients, you have a differentiable world simulator, you can do optimization by gradient descent. I'm a big fan of gradient. Like, you know, I hate discrete stuff because, you know, I don't know how to, like, propagate gradients, learn stuff there. So, yeah.
So I tried to do this in 1999 in the very, very small world of insurance pricing.
Uh-huh.
So my world simulator tried to simulate what happens if the insurance company changes prices. And I thought it'd be pretty simple and easy for me to then show insurance companies how to do that better. The challenge was it took 10 years, because when you use this technique, when the world is something which is not easily explainable with a small number of presets,
right,
the actor-critic system ends up finding the stupid edge cases. So we had 10 years of trying to remove stupid edge cases. Eventually it worked, but this kind of system can be a bit, it's dangerously kind of convenient to look at, but horrifying once you get into it for a complex world.
Well, there's a number of horrifying pieces here. I mean, the first one is you probably need a lot of examples. If your world model is complicated, you probably need lots of examples to train it, and they have to be diverse enough that they cover the space of all possible things that can happen in the world, right? And so that's a big problem. In classical control, when people do this, they build a model by hand, right? So for example, you know, Boston Dynamics, when they build their like walking robot, they do planning the way I describe, but they have very accurate dynamical models of their robot, and that they have gradients for. I mean, they have Jacobians for, so they can propagate through it. It works there because you have an accurate model of the world. Now, in reality, particularly for insurance and things like this, or you know, financial data, but for just about anything in the world, there is stochasticity, and therefore this model is necessarily wrong. Therefore, it diverges really quickly when you run it multiple times, and you have to handle this. That's the main failure mode.
Can I just add one more thing? So the biggest challenge is the edge cases. Like, an insurance company doesn't know what happens when you drop prices by half because they've never done it before. So like predictive models, you know, you need something that can see beyond data you've seen before.
Yeah, yeah. But it's basically, it comes down to, you know, how you train this forward model, how much, you know, with limited amounts of data, et cetera. So here's a very quick example. This is a paper that's probably going to pop up on archive within a couple of weeks, and where we trained a neural net. It's a particular type of entity RNN, which I guess you mentioned in your talk. But it's kind of a slightly updated form of it, where you have like one separate recurrent net that kind of controls simulates the behavior of billiard balls. And then you have interactions between those neural nets that the system can use to kind of learn how billiard balls behave when they bounce on each other. And what we did there is train a forward model of this thing that can roll out with reasonable accuracy for a while, and then using this the gradient descent based planning, learn to hit the ball so that the red ball goes into the hole, and it kind of works. I mean, it actually works most of the time. So that's not like super innovative. There's another part of the paper that's a little more innovative. That's kind of classical optimal control, except for the fact that the model of the world here is not a dynamical model that's been built by hand. It's basically built by observation using this one of those entity RNN. So that's a little bit of the innovation there. I'll come back to this entity RNN stuff. So how do we learn predictive models of the world? There is some work from a couple of years ago by some of my colleagues at Facebook, Adam Lehrer, Sam Gross, and Rob Fergus, on kind of trying to learn intuitive physics. There's really interesting work also from Josh Tenenbaum's group at MIT and you know, some groups at DeepMind as well, in Corey Cavachoglu's group at DeepMind. And the idea there is you train a ConvNet essentially to predict what's going to happen to a tower of cubes and in which direction the cubes are going to fall. So again, it's predicting masks of objects. And we use a 3D game engine here, Unreal, and you know, train it on lots of experiments to predict where cubes are going to fall. And it does a decent job. And after that, you know, you can actually show real cubes in real video, and it does a decent job at predicting what's going to happen. Here's a few more examples. But what you notice is that when it's difficult to predict what's going to happen, so this is the ground truth. This is what actually happens when you run the simulation. And this is what the neural net predict is going to happen. You get this kind of fuzzy predictions. You know, it's not entirely possible to predict exactly what's going to happen. And so the network predicts some average of a whole bunch of possible futures. And you get those fuzzy predictions. And that's a problem we have to deal with, right? Since we were talking about entity RNN, here is an example. This is not a model to predict the state of the world. This is or the future state of the world. This is a model to infer the current state of the world from partial information. And it uses this idea of augmenting neural nets with memory. People invented recurrent neural nets way back when for the reason that it's the best way for, you know, it's a good way for a neural net to remember past events, right? It's kind of accumulate knowledge about the past in its recurrent connection. Turns out it doesn't work. Turns out after 20 iterations, most recurrent nets forget their initial state. And if they don't forget their initial state, they become very difficult to train as well, because if they have memory, then that means their state doesn't change, which means when you backpropagate gradient, you get zeros. So recurrent nets suck at storing stuff. And so one idea has been in recent years, so LSTM is along those lines. But more recently, things like memory, various types of memory augmented network, like the memory network from Jason Weston and other people at Facebook, the stack augmented recurrent neural net from Armand Joulin and Tomasz Mikolov, also at Facebook, neural Turing machine from DeepMind, and the kind of updated version of it, differentiable neural computer, also from DeepMind. Those are all neural nets augmented with a piece of memory, essentially, that is really built to be a kind of a factual memory as opposed to something where you can learn skills. You have to build it in such a way that it's differentiable so that you can insert it into a neural net. And so I'm not going to go into the details of how those memory networks are built, but basically the memory in a memory network is a little different in the differentiable neural computer. It's basically a RAM circuit, more or less, except it's soft instead of being hard. Instead of being binary, it's kind of soft, and so you can propagate gradient to it. So you fill an address, which is a vector. You compare this vector to a bunch of keys, and using cosine distance, for example, and you get a bunch of scores here corresponding to the cosine distance. You feed that to a softmax. You get a bunch of coefficients that are between 0 and 1 and sum to 1. And the output of the memory is a bunch of values that are linearly combined using those coefficients. So if the input matches one key exactly, you get at the output, you get that, more or less. But it's all soft and differentiable. So you can insert this into a recurrent net. So you can do question answering, for example. Have a machine read a piece of text, store the text as a bunch of key and values in the memory through some process, embedding each sentence basically into a vector. And then run a recurrent net, maybe for 3 time steps, where the recurrent net gets a question and then produces an address for the memory, recovers a fact, crunches on it, and then produces another address for the memory, recovers a fact, crunches on it, et cetera. And then at the end, produces an answer, and then supervisedly, you give it the correct answer, you backpropagate through the whole thing, and magically, the stuff figures out how to generate addresses that will produce relevant facts to answer the question and will answer the question. We kind of have the machine read, Lord of the Rings in 15 sentences, and then answer a question about where is the ring, where is Bilbo, etc. This sort of more complex task called the baby task. So this is Jason Weston and his colleagues, also at Facebook, where they came up with sort of 20 types of questions that you might want to ask a machine, and those memory networks can solve about 19 out of the 20 reasonably well, but not all 20. And what happened with this entity RNN is that it's the first model we have that can solve all 20 of the baby tasks. So the kind of questions that are asked is things like, Mary journeyed to the den, Mary went back to the kitchen, John journeyed to the bedroom, Mary discarded the milk, where was the milk before the den? Or Brian is a lion, Julius is a lion, Julius is white, Bernard is green, what color is Brian, if you assume all lions are white, et cetera. I mean, there's sort of simple inferences, the things that require you to count, there are things that require you to know geometry, things like that. And entity RNN is the first one that solves all of them. So this is going to be presented at ICLR next month. So in an entity RNN, you have a bank of recurrent nets, which are a little bit like at STM in the sense that they, by default, they kind of keep their previous state. But a current sentence, so the way you use an entity RNN is that there is a sequence of events that occur in the world. Either they're described to you in the form of text. So for example, John goes to the kitchen. And what you'd like the system to do is, if it has a cell that represents the content of the kitchen, that it should be updated with John. And if you have another cell that represents where John is, it should be updated with kitchen. Right. So the process would be an event comes in, and each of the cell decides whether the event is relevant to it. If it is, it updates its value with a combination of its previous value and whatever comes in from the external world. Okay. And there's no interaction between the cells. And the form of the formula that gives you the new state from the previous state is very, very simple. There's a multiplicative interaction for the gating, and then there is just a linear combination to update the state. So very simple. And you do this, unfold this in time. The way you train this is you have the machine read a bunch of very simple sentences, like John goes to the kitchen, John picks up the milk, et cetera, things like that. Mary goes to the kitchen, she drops the bowl, blah, 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 blah. And at the end, you ask a question, like, how many people are in the kitchen? Or is there anyone in the kitchen? Or is the milk in the kitchen? Or where was the milk before Mary got here? Or things like that. At the end, you ask that question, you give the correct answer, and then you backpropagate through, and magically, the machine figures out how to track the state of the world so that the last state that it produces has enough information to answer the question. In the end, in fact, the stuff that are stored in this entity RNN are not individual objects. They are kind of distributed. The properties of objects are actually distributed across multiple cells, which allows the system to actually account for interactions between objects. And as I said, it's the first one, the entity net, that can have low error rates on all 20 of the tasks. OK, so that's one example of a system that can be used to kind of keep track of discrete states in the world. And I showed in the billiard example, it's a very similar system that has also interactions between the cells that can actually keep track of the state of and predict the state, the future states of a more continuous space. But let's talk about unsupervised running now. How much time do I have? Unsupervised running, the difference between supervised running and unsupervised running is not conceptually that big, really. It's a difference between the fact that in supervised running, the variable you are asking the machine to predict is reliable, right? Show the picture of a car and you tell it's a car and it's a car. Whereas in unsupervised running, you don't quite know what the correct answer is. So for example, let's imagine your entire world consists of two pixels, y1 and y2, and your entire universe consists of those percepts. These are the points that you observe. There is some dependency between y1 and y2, and you'd like your machine to be able to capture the dependency so that if you only know y1, you can predict more or less what the value of y2 is. Or if you only know y2, you can tell there is basically two regions where y1 is likely to be for this regime. So how do you capture the dependency between variables when it's not a direct mapping from y1 to y2 or y2 to y1? And one sort of classical way of handling this is you learn a contrast function, or a value function, or an energy function, or a negative log probability density, or whatever you want to call it, doesn't matter. Some function that takes low values on the data points and higher values everywhere else. Okay. So let's call it an energy function for this purpose here. And so the problem of unsupervised running now becomes, how do you learn a function that takes an input, a vector, and then tells you with a single scalar value whether the input looks like the training set or not? So feed it an image, and it tells you whether it's a natural-looking image, or it tells you that is not a natural-looking image, in which case it produces a higher value. So what we need to do is train this machine to learn this contrast function. And there's an easy part to it. The easy part is I give you one of those blue beads, one of those training samples. I can tweak the parameters of this function so that the output is small. Okay, very simple. Propagate gradients, tweak the parameters so that the output goes down. Trivial. The problem is, how do we make sure the function takes higher values outside of those samples? And if you are a probabilist, you like probabilistic modeling, it's the partition function problem, right? If you want to give high probability to something, you have to give low probability to other things, because otherwise, you know, overall it has to normalize, right? So like a learning algorithm to shape the energy function kind of like this, right? It kind of, you know, digs a groove in our energy surface. But how do we make sure the energy outside of the data is large? So one simple trick is you throw a bunch of points with some smart process or some random process, and they have a good chance of falling outside of your manifold of data. For example, those green points, and those, you push them up. So you basically compute the gradient of the output of your energy function with respect to the parameters, and you tweak the parameters so that the output goes up. So if you do this enough time, this energy will go up, the energy of that will go down, and the thing will take the right shape. In high-dimensional spaces, though, that's kind of impractical because there's a high dimensional, you know, there's a high volume of things that you can push up, and you never know if you've pushed up enough. So if you're a probabilist, you know, you can turn this energy function into a probability density through a Gibbs distribution, and you know, implicitly, if you do maximum likelihood, you will have this kind of pushing up effect. But it only works if your partition function has a gradient that's tractable, which, of course, in practice, most of the time, it's not. So I've come up over the years with 7 different strategies to shape the energy function in the right way, used by sort of various well-known algorithms. So things like PCA, k-means, Gaussian mixture model, square ICA, et cetera. They basically fix the volume of stuff that can take low energy. And so you can move that thing around, but everything else will have higher energy as a consequence because they are normalized models, or they are designed in such a way that only a subspace can take low energy. You have, you know, traditional probabilistic method where you push down on the energy of data points and push up everywhere else. But the problem is that you need a tractable partition function to be able to do this. You can push down the energy of data points, push up on chosen location. So this is what contrastive divergence, minimal probability flow, noise contrastive estimation, ratio matching, all of those methods do this. You know, anything that has Monte Carlo in it or Markov-Chain Monte Carlo in it does this. And you know, there's sort of various other things. Denoising autoencoder has kind of another trick for doing that. There is a trick which is to limit the amount of information. So you build your model as an autoencoder, and you use the energy function as a reconstruction error, and you put some constraints in the hidden layer in such a way that this hidden layer can only take kind of a small number of different configurations effectively through sparsity or by adding noise, and that kind of works. And this is what sparse coding, sparse autoencoders, as well as variational autoencoders do, essentially. That's the idea they're based on.
It seems that this is ignoring a big problem, which is feature selection or representation.
Yeah.
There's an implicit assumption in representation is such that under this representation, things are smooth or things are Lipschitz. So where did you get this representation from if all I get is unlabeled data from the world?
Well, there is implicit smoothness in the world, right? I mean, I'm going to come to this in a minute. So I think a lot of those constraints are in the architecture of the predictor that you build or in the regularizers that you use when you train, but not necessarily in the principle of learning that I'm talking about here, essentially. So I think it's kind of an orthogonal question from this, but tell me at the end if I didn't answer properly. Okay, there's one, I'm not going to mention the other ones. There is one I left out here, which is adversarial training, and that's the one I'm the most fond of at the moment. So adversarial training is really where things are. So these are examples of energy functions that you would get by doing, you know, in two dimension, if you have training samples along this spiral, and you know, PCA gives you kind of a energy function that has low values along the principal axis. K-means, you know, puts prototypes all around, and so you have that, likelihood, I'm going to skip this. Sparse coding gives you an approximation of the manifold through piecewise linear. But really, all of this, I've been working on those problems for the last 15 years, but I kind of stopped everything and started working on adversarial training because I think it's the answer to that problem, or at least is very promising, I think. So adversarial training is an idea that came out of Yoshua Bengio's lab by Ian Goodfellow 2.5 years ago or so, where he viewed this as a way to train a generative model to predict things. But there are two ways to view adversarial training, which I come back to in a minute. One is, how do you train a generator to predict things? And the other one is, how do you train one of those contrast functions, and how do you choose the contrasty point smartly? And basically use another neural net, which is a generator for that. I'll come back to this. OK, so here is the problem that adversarial training is attempting to solve. You want to make predictions. For example, you want to train a forward model of the world, and you want to train it with raw videos, right? So you show the system a few frames of a video, and you ask it what's going to happen in the next half second or something, you know, in the next few frames of the video. So that's the past. That's the prediction, say, one frame of in the future. And the machine has access to a source of random vectors. So let's say its entire world consists in me putting a pen on the table and letting it go. That's all the videos it sees. And so the future, the possible futures are all, you know, the pen folding in one direction or another. And so it's kind of a set of possible futures, right? In this case, it's actually a kind of a topologically round ribbon, but let's forget that for a moment. This is just a figurative representation. So let's say the machine, for the particular past it has observed, predicts that the pen is going to fall to the left. And that's this point on this manifold of plausible futures. And I use manifold in a loose sense, right? It's not differentiable or anything. But let's say we let the future occur, and we look at future actual frames in the data. And what the world tells us is that this is what happened. The pen actually fell to the back. So I don't want to punish the machine for not making the right choice, okay? Because conceptually it's correct. It just, there was no way it could predict exactly what was going to happen. So I'd like to find an objective function that will tell the machine, as long as you produce a point that's on this set of plausible futures, I'm not going to punish you. It's only if you deviate from that I'm going to punish you, right? So what I need here is a cost function, which is basically a contrast function that tells me low if you're on this manifold, high if you're outside of it. And that's exactly the stuff I was talking about before, which is this model of unsupervised learning as a contrast function for things that are good and things that are bad. And so we're going to use, of course, we have no way of characterizing this this surface in advance. And so we're going to use a second neural net model, parameterized model, whatever it is, and train it to produce this contrast function. And the way adversarial training does it, which I'm sure many of you are aware of, there's a lot of fans of adversarial training at Berkeley as well, Alyosha Efros and his group, among others, is like this. You train the discriminator to tell you the difference between real futures and not real futures, namely, in this case, the ones that are produced by the predictor, by the generator. Okay, so the discriminator trains itself to produce low values for actual frames from the data, and to produce higher values for things that come out of the generator, whatever it is. Easy enough. The generator, conversely, trains itself to produce predictions that the discriminator cannot tell are not real. And the way it does this is that it adjusts its parameters so as to minimize the output of the discriminator. And it can do this because the discriminator is differentiable, so we can propagate gradient all the way through. We can get gradients of the output of the discriminator with respect to the output of the generator, and then with respect to the parameters of the generator, right? So you have two loss functions, one minimized by the discriminator, which is, you know, make this low, make this high. Another one minimized by the generator, which is make that stuff out there low. And those functions don't have to be the same, can be different. So this is the energy-based view of adversarial training, where the generator is going to produce those green points that are outside of the predictions suck, and so it's not going to be good. The energy of those green points is going to be pushed up. The energy of those blue points is going to be pushed down. So eventually you'll get something like this, because simultaneously the generator is going to learn to move its green points towards low energy areas. And so you get two networks that are trained now at the end against each other, This guy can't tell the difference between what the generator produces and what the data produces. And the generator produces things that really look like real data. So this is called energy-based GANs, this formulation of GANs. This is, again, a paper at ICLR next month. Of course, there's a lot of examples of GANs. These are not energy-based GANs. These are traditional GANs that can do phase arithmetics and stuff like that, which I'm sure you're aware of. There's a particular architecture for energy-based GAN that we use where the discriminator is actually an autoencoder. So it takes an image and it runs through an encoder, which is a convolutional encoder, convolutional decoder, measures the reconstruction error. And you stick this into two cost functions, one for the discriminator, one for the generator. And there's one thing you have a choice of what objective function you use. So this guy has two terms because there's one term it tries to bring down. Basically, for real data, you want the difference, the reconstruction error, to be low. And for unreal data, for fake data produced by the generator, you want the reconstruction error to be larger. And so you put a hinge loss with a margin. And that way, the reconstruction error is pushed to be larger than the margin. And for the generator, it's very simple. You want the output of the discriminator, which is decoder of encoder of G of Z, to be small. And there's a few theorems you can prove. It was proved by my student, Michael Mathieu, who said, for various characteristics of those pair of objective function, there is an Nash equilibrium. And if it is reached, then the distributions produced by G of X and the distribution of real data are identical. You have to make various assumptions, but that's pretty much what it comes down to. So this kind of stuff, this is another type of energy-based GAN where the discriminator now is one of those ladder networks. So I don't know if you guys have heard of this. It's basically a fully connected network that takes MNIST digits, runs them through a bunch of layers, but there is connections coming at the side that allow the system to reconstruct the input. So you wouldn't be able to reconstruct the input just from labels, for example, right? Because there's not enough information in the label to reconstruct the image. And so you have those side connections that kind of help the decoder instantiate the reconstruction. You use this as the discriminator, and you have a generator that just produces characters. It's kind of a fully connected net as well. And the cool thing about this is that you can use the discriminator trained unsupervised on MNIST, and then fine-tune it so that on just a few label samples, so that the output here is actually labels of characters. And with just a few training samples, something like 1,000 training samples, you can get less than 1% error on MNIST. Okay, it's MNIST, but that's actually quite good. Not so long ago, we weren't able to go below 1% with a regular neural net on the entire data set with distortions. So energy-based GANs can generate images. These are an EBGAN trained on ImageNet, and then you just have it generate images. They're not globally consistent, so these are not objects, okay? But they look nice from the back. These are dogs, so you train the EBGAN on dogs. You get kind of soft dogs. Again, the sort of microstructure is respected, but the global characteristics aren't. These are examples of video prediction. So it's a multi-scale convolutional net that looks at 4 frames in the past and predicts two frames, I believe, in the future. So this is what happens when you train this neural net using L2. So the first 4 frames are observed, and when they turn red on the outside, that's the predictions. And so if you train with L2, you get blurry predictions because the best thing the machine can do is predict an average of all the possible futures that can happen, and basically it doesn't know which one, so it produces blurry prediction. And these are the predictions you get with adversarial training with a few tricks, and you get pretty crisp prediction of how this wire is going to change, how the hands are going to move, this boy is going to move, the girl is going to move her head forward, etc. These are other examples. Let me show you the second one. So this is trained on short video snippets shot in apartments in New York where the camera rotates. And so essentially here, this is a test set, and the first few frames are observed. So here there is bookshelves, and those bookshelves here are invented because it's never seen those bookshelves before, and the camera turns, it's going to make up what the apartment looks like. That part of the couch here is made up. that library here is made up, the back of it. So it's clear that the thing has captured some structure, okay, of the data. Now, the next question would be, is it the case that the internal representations learned by this predictor can be helpful to learn a particular task in recognition, for example? And so far, the experiments, the simple experiments we've done with this show that it's not clear. Like, you know, you're still better off using supervised learning if you have data. Okay, so, but presumably it will actually improve a lot if labeled data is very scarce. And those things go haywire after only a few frames. So, you know, past 10, 20 frames, you get those really blurry predictions that really are awful. And so one thing that we're working on is, and this is a paper in submission, is to not work directly in pixel space, but in sort of feature space, particularly semantic segmentation space. So you run a semantic segmenter that's been trained to do this in supervised mode on single frames. And so you get those maps like this. And then you ask the system, can you predict what those segmentation maps are going to look like in the future? So again, here you have two observed frames, and then the last three frames are predicted. But in fact, they skip every three frames, so it's really nine frames ahead. It's about half a second of real-time prediction. And what you see is that you have cars. You have a car here moving to the left, and the prediction is that it's going to keep moving to the left. Okay, that makes sense. You have a pedestrian crossing the street, and the prediction is it's going to keep crossing the street. So that's the kind of stuff you would want for a self-driving car, right? It's going to be able to predict ahead what's going to happen and where objects are going to move, so that you slow down if you predict things might go haywire or if a car moves towards you, right? So it's kind of you need this to do this kind of planning, because the alternative is to actually wait for a crash to happen, okay, and then through your reinforcement learning, learn that you probably shouldn't do what you just did, and then repeat this 4 million times before you actually learn not to crash, okay? So that's just not an option. So that's the reason why model-based RL is the salvation. Okay, I'm going to stop here. Thank you very much.
Can you say a little bit more about what you think about this relationship between this kind of real inference process that actually does reason with a planner forward, and then a policy that is one that kind of knows without having to execute intuitively knows what to do.
Right.
Yeah, that's interesting.
So I don't know about you, but I'm terrible at chess. On a couple of occasions, I was in a situation where I was playing like a simultaneous game with like a grandmaster, right? And the guy was playing against 50 people, and I would think about the thing for I don't know, 5 minutes, right? The time for him to kind of go around and like make a move, and then he would get to me and go like, and go, right? And then in five shots, I was dead. So he's been able, because of practice, to compile some kind of reasoned tree exploration and planning into just a completely intuitive pattern recognition type thing. I mean, this is also the secret of AlphaGo. The first module in AlphaGo is a convolutional net that looks at the Go band and just predicts where with some probability distribution where you should play. By imitation learning, supervised learning, essentially, from grandmasters. So that's the intuitive part of it. And then there is the second part, which is the more kind of tree exploration, MCTS, and all that stuff, right? So you might want both. The first one helps the second one, but then if you do the second one better, then you can refine the first one by sort of compiling your knowledge. So it's the same thing when you learn a new skill, right? You learn to, kite surf or ski, right? And you're kind of hesitant, and you people tell you what you have to do, and you sort of plan with more or less what's going to happen, and you're scared because every prediction you make basically results in you falling. So so you tend to be careful. And in the end, you kind of compile this into a set of reactive moves that allow you to ski or kite surf or whatever it is. So I believe in this process of deliberate planning followed by direct learning of the policy using targets generated by the deliberate planning.
So one thing you mentioned just recently is that the best in this video prediction task is that the best thing it can do is to predict the average of the possible outcomes, but the average is not an outcome itself, right?
That's right. That's right. If the manifold is curved, then the average of all the possibility is actually not a good prediction. The average of my face here and my face here is not a face. Yes.
So, but in other problems, you didn't seem to have this problem, like with this car. So how do you avoid predicting the average, which is often would be best, I don't know, for convex losses or something like this? Then,
well, I mean, you know, it's true that. So it turns out here. You can use adversarial training, or you can use a simpler form of training. The simpler form of training actually works quite well. The difference with adversarial training is not obvious. With the number, you can tell it's slightly better. But in terms of subjective prediction, it's not that worse. It turns out things that happen in street views are actually eminently predictable. You know, cars have a lot of inertia, so they tend to kind of continue on their path. People are more or less predictable. It's when something very unpredictable occurs that you have to react, right? You know, a ball crosses the street and there is a child running after it, right? That's not entirely predictable. So those are the things you want to pay attention to. In fact, it's quite possible that one way of building self-driving cars is not only to have predictive models that allow you to plan in advance, but also to see when your predictive model fails and then kind of say, oh, let me slow down because there is something going on here that I don't understand. And there's a lot of problems that occur with deep learning, or I mean machine learning in general, that I think could be moderated with predictive or generative models of this type.
You mentioned transfer learning towards the start. It seems like that's likely to be very important for this kind of general area of trying to tackle lots of problems over a long period of time. I was wondering if you have any tips about building architectures that are good for transfer learning. It seems like I haven't seen any papers which explicitly say here's a way of like designing something which is going to be good at transfer learning, and some of the more recent architectures like ResNet and Inception don't seem to be as good at transfer learning as VGG, for instance.
So basically, I mean, this is one thing that, it used to be that transfer learning was like a subfield of machine learning, like people were actually explicitly working on this. And since the emergence of deep learning, it's kind of obvious that you can do transfer learning because the representation is learned for whatever task, and so you put multiple heads to your neural net for the various tasks you want to solve, and you pre-train on the one for which you have lots of label data, and then you fine-tune on other tasks, or you train all tasks simultaneously, and the system gets better on each individual task. I had a paper on this in 2003 for phase detection and pose estimation, where you train the system to do both at the same time, and you get better results either on phase detection and on both phase detection and pose estimation if you train simultaneously. So. People do this now for translation, where you train a multiple language translation system and it gets better at every language, and it works better for languages for which you have a small amount of data. It works better for speech recognition. You can do multilingual speech recognition engines where it's basically a ConvNet or a RecurrentNet, whatever it is, with multiple heads for each language, and it gets better, particularly on languages that have a small amount of labeled data. Because the trunk of it is common. It's has to do with signals and voice and stuff like that. So it's kind of trivial, which is probably why there is no paper on it.
Well, except when it's a new area that you didn't know about when you first trained it. You want to reuse that representation of this.
Right. So there is one problem, for example, that people like your neighbor at Uber are interested in, and I'm interested in a project I'm working on with NVIDIA is with my NYU hat on. How do you train a self-driving car system in a simulator and then transfer the behavior in the real world?
Or X-rays from ImageNet,
For example.
How do you build an architecture that's
right.
from ImageNet
yep.
that's going to be better at X-rays?
Right. So those are examples that are harder to do for transfer learning because it's the input that changes. It's not just the output that's different. It's not the classes that you change. The nature and the statistics of the input is different. So doing transfer there is harder. But, working on it.
Maybe we should break for lunch now, and there'll be time for questions also at the panel discussion, four or five. I hope you'll be there.
Yeah.